Hello everyone, a very good morning to all. So in this video we'll be discussing about oxides of group 17 elements. So all halogens form oxides, but fluorine form fluorides, or we can say the compounds of all the halogens except for fluorines are called as oxides. And if we talk about the compounds of fluorine with oxygen, those will be called as fluorides, because fluorine is more electronegative in comparison to that of oxygen, and all the other halogens are less electronegative than oxygen. So their compounds with oxygen will be called as oxides, and compounds of fluorine with oxygen will be called as fluorides. So important oxides of group, important oxides, or we can say fluorides in case of oxygen, for group 17 elements, they exhibit these oxidation states, and these are the oxides which are known for these elements. So all these oxides are powerful oxidizing agents which explodes when subjected to shock and heat. So they are quite sensitive compounds. The first one which we are going to discuss is OF2, that is oxygen fluoride. So it is prepared by passing fluorine gas through 2% solution of aqueous NaOH. This is the preparation. So it is colorless, poisonous gas, which condenses to pale yellow liquid. It is used as fluorinating agent. It dissolves in water to form oxygen, but explodes with steam. So this is the reaction it gives with water. It produces oxygen, and it explodes with steam, and it is readily hydrolyzed by base, giving oxygen. So with base also it gives oxygen, and with the H2S it also gives explosive reaction. So this reaction can be used as a rocket fuel. So if we talk about its structure here, Z comes out to be 4. That means hybridization is going to be sp3. So it is having a water-like bent geometry. Next, we have dioxygen difluoride, that is O2F2, where oxygen is in -1 oxidation state. So where fluorine is in -1 oxidation state and oxygen is in +1 oxidation state. So it is prepared by the mixture of O2 and F2 taken. It is passed, electric discharge is passed at -196 degrees Celsius. We'll get the formation of O2F2. It is highly unstable, which decomposes into elements at -160. So when the temperature, it forms at -196, and as the temperature rises to -160, it decomposes. And it is yellow orange kind of solid. So it is fluorinating agent at low temperature. At low temperature, its application is, it is used as fluorinating agent. It can convert CLF into CLF3, BRF3 into BRF5, SF4 into SF6. With H2S, it gives the kind of reaction that it acts as a fluorinating agent for sulfur, and it converts it to SF6, hexafluorosulfur. So it is having a skew structure which is very much similar to that of H2O2, with oxygen-oxygen distance much shorter in comparison to that of H2O2, and OF bond distance much longer in comparison to that of H2O2. So here are the bond distances for this molecule, and H2O2 bond distances have been mentioned here. So we can easily see that oxygen-oxygen bond distance is smaller here, and OH, or we can say OF bond distance, is larger here in comparison to that of H2O2. Next one is Cl2O, where chlorine is in +1 oxidation state. So it is prepared by treating freshly precipitated out mercuric oxide with chlorine gas, and we get the formation of Cl2O. So with alkalis, it doesn't give such kind of reaction. With alkalis, it gives NaClO, that is hypochlorite, sodium hypochlorite. It is brownish yellow gas at room temperature. It explodes upon heating. Anhydride is it is anhydride of hypochlorous acid. The anhydrides we can easily memorize by the trick. So you need not memorize the anhydrides directly. It is used as oxidizing agent. It can oxidize HCl to chlorine gas. Its gaseous mixture with ammonia is explosive in nature, which produces ammonium chloride, and it is actually used in explosives. So its structure is, again, if we talk about its structure, it is sp3 hybridized. Here oxygen is sp3 hybridized, just like water. two lone pairs, two bond pairs with bent geometry. Now, if we talk about the bond angles in case of OX2 type of compounds, if we have in case of OF2, the bond angle is 103 degree. In OCl2, it is 111, and OBr2, it is 111. So that means as we are moving down the group for halogens, bond angle is increasing. Now, why this bond angle is increasing? Because the electronegativity difference between the oxygen and the halogen atom is increasing. Here, fluorine is more electronegative. That means the bond pairs are lying more towards the fluorine, so that is why bond angle is smaller. But in case of chlorine and oxygen, electronegativity of oxygen is more than fluorine, so bond pairs are lying, electron bond pairs are lying more towards the oxygen, and whenever they are closer to the central atom, they exhibits more repulsions and bond angle widens. And in case of OBr, the bond angle further widens because oxygen is far more electronegative in comparison to that of bromine. Next, we have ClO2, where chlorine is in plus 4 oxidation state. It is prepared by treating sodium chloride with chlorine gas in air. So it is used as strong oxidant in water. It dissolves in water. It gives exothermic reaction, and it will form two acids, that is chloric acid and chlorous acid. So it can be called as mixed anhydride of these two. So if we treat it water in the presence of light, we'll get the formation of HClO and HCl. With alkalis, it gives mixture of chlorides and chlorates. If we talk about its structure is quite unique, where Z comes out to be 3.5, which is quite not possible. So this odd means there must be multi-centered bonding is there, which cannot be explained by normal methods. So yes, this OCl bond is 3-electron-2-center bond. So bond length is in between the single and double bond, and bond angle is greater than 117 degrees. Next one is Cl2O6, that is dichlorohexoxide. So it can be prepared by the treatment of ClO2 with oxygen, that is oxidation of ClO2. So it is strong oxidizing agent. It is a dark red liquid. With alkalis, it gives a mixture of chlorate and perchlorate. Earlier, when we treated this, that is ClO2 with alkalis, we got the mixture of chloride and chlorate. So here we are getting chlorates and perchlorate. So it is diamagnetic, but in its vapor form, it exists in the form of its monomer, which is paramagnetic. Next one is Cl2O7. It is prepared from HClO4. It is dehydrated, it is prepared from the dehydration of the perchloric acid, that is HClO4. So that means it is a anhydride of this perchloric acid. So when upon hydrolysis, it will give us perchloric acid. It is most stable oxide of chlorine. The structure is kind of like this, Cl2O7. Then we have Br2O. It is prepared by dropping bromine over dry mercuric oxide at 50 to 70 degrees Celsius in CCl4. So it is anhydride of hypobromous acid. With alkalis, it gives us hypobromides. Structure is similar to that of Cl2O and F2O. Next, we have bromine dioxide, where bromine is in plus 4 oxidation state, prepared from the oxidation of bromine by passing electric discharge. With alkalis, it will give us a mixture of bromide and hypobromides. So the reaction with alkalis, hydrolysis reaction, what are the anhydrides? These are the important reactions which you are supposed to keep in mind while studying these oxides and their preparation reaction also. So BrO3, next one is, it's here bromine is in plus 6 oxidation state. It can be prepared by treating bromine with oxygen at low temperature and passing electric discharge. Because it decomposes above minus 80 degrees Celsius, that is why low temperature is maintained. So it is a strong oxidizing agent. It gives acidic solution in water. Next one and the last oxide of the halogens is I2O5. It is kind of very important. Its chemistry is interesting. This is obtained from iodic acid upon heating. That means it is the anhydride of this iodic acid. This I2O5 has great affinity for water. So this is a strong oxidizing agent, and this is a hygroscopic solid. So it can oxidize H2S2, sulfur, HCl to chlorine. This is the structure. It is planar structure. So it exhibits an interesting reaction with carbon monoxide. That is, with carbon monoxide, it gives the formation of carbon dioxide and I2 gas. So here I2 gas, which is released, this can be titrated against sodium sulfide to know the concentration of carbon monoxide. So it is used for the estimation of carbon monoxide, this reaction, where I2O5 is a major component, which is to react with carbon monoxide to release I2, which is to be estimated, which is to be measured for the estimation of carbon monoxide. So this is how it is done. Next, we have oxoacids. The details of oxoacids, will be dealing with oxoacids in the next video. So that is it for this video. Thank you so much. Have a good rest of the day.